the leap from the lion's head, he proved his worth. It's impossible. Nobody can jump this.
Indy! Indy, you must hurry! Come quickly!
It's a leap of faith.
You must believe, boy. You must believe.
There's all kinds of things we could mention just about in that video clip about stepping out in faith. Sometimes we think that we've used that phrase. You know, it's just a leap of faith. We need to step out in faith. But there's more to it than just having a hope that it's going to work out, or I wish that it's going to work out. There's something a bit more solid than that. And so sometimes we have to ask ourselves whether we're stepping out in faith or are we following a foolish impulse on our own part. And so we have to discern how we are stepping out in faith. And so at the very beginning, I'm going to take a look at these first four things about faith before we actually get into our passage. The first, and I promise, all these blanks just have one word, and so you don't have to write a whole lot. Anyway, the first is that faith is common. Faith really is common. It means it's universal. Everybody has faith. The atheist has faith, the Buddhist, the Christian, everyone. We've never really met anybody that does not have faith. The key is, what do we have faith in? That makes all the difference. The second thing is, faith is conversion. To have true faith in Jesus, we have to switch our allegiances from the old dependencies of this world to new dependency upon Jesus Christ, and that is conversion. When you have faith, your Savior becomes Jesus rather than the false gods that we tend to embrace. Bud Livers is leading the class on Wednesday nights about gods at war. He's discussing all these false gods that we embrace and we worship, which prevents us from worshiping the true and living God. The third thing is faith is contemplative. Not a word that we use too often. It sounds very mystic and monkish to be contemplative, but faith is a response to seeing and knowing Jesus. When we contemplate him, we really dwell upon him, we meditate upon him, and therefore we come to trust him because of our contemplation. The man is told in his story, "You may go, your son will live," which is not what he expected to hear. So we have to think about it for just a moment. It's not what he expected to hear. But what happens here is that which God speaks happens. That's what we see in this story. So if you want greater faith, then we have to really contemplate Jesus. The fourth thing is faith is continual. Now when we move out in faith, we find confirmation for our faith as we go through everyday life. I think those of us who have walked in faith for a while, we recognize this as a very true fact. It is a continual, never-ending process of trusting Jesus. It's stepping out on the basis of faith, finding confirmation, gaining more faith. Therefore, we can step out in faith again. He's proven dependable and faithful in the past. Therefore, we can trust him in our current situation. So, what does this story that was read have to do with faith? And so let's take a look at that. Last week was all about the woman at the well. Story ended with a Samaritan woman testifying that Jesus was the promised Messiah, and many people believed in him. I love John adds another statement in verse 42, I believe it is, he says, it's no longer because of what you have said. This is what the townspeople said. It's no longer what you have said that we believe, for we had heard for ourselves, and we know that this one is indeed the Savior of the world. And so they came to faith, not just on the testimony of the woman, but they came to faith based upon the word of Jesus. Just his word. And we're going to see how this plays into what's going to happen in this next part of the story. We come to this episode in the life of Jesus, the healing of this official's son, which is, it says in the text, that this is the second major sign of miracles which John used to reinforce Jesus' true identity. John uses that word signs because it's not just a miracle for the sake of doing something miraculous. It is a sign that points to something much greater, and that's why I think he uses that particular word. And so we're trying to get the true identity of Jesus. So let's take a walk through the story and discover some spiritual truth about the significance of a life of faith. The first thing I want you to see in the beginning of this passage in verse 43 through 46a are the places. The places that that Jesus had been. Jesus considers several things here at the beginning of this particular passage. The text says that after two eventful days in Samaria, the woman at the well, and then the teaching about evangelism and the harvest being plentiful and the laborers being few, Jesus continues toward Galilee. We see that there's this interesting, if not odd, statement that Jesus mentions here. He says that a prophet has no honor except in his hometown, which seems very odd for him to quote this proverb here. The scolding seems to appear directed toward Judah more so than the man. And so think about what is happening here if it was toward Judah, because there is really is a reason that the people were not so much excited about Jesus, but rather they were excited for what he had done for them. They liked the miracles. They thought this was the greatest show on earth. And they said, hey, come and see Jesus. He's coming to town. So we got some things that we get to see. He'll be quite entertaining from what we're used to here in our town. And so it was contrasted between Samaria and Judea. Jerusalem gave him no honor. His claims of being the Messiah, that claim was unwelcome. And so he says at the end of chapter 2 of John's gospel that he did not entrust himself to the Jews. Basically, many believed in him, but he did not believe in them. That's really what was happening at the end of chapter 2. He did not entrust himself to them. And the word for believe and the word entrust have basically the same root word, the same word in Greek. And so while many people eventually follow Jesus, they love the miracles more than the Messiah. That's what we find here. And this really sets up the rest of the story. And so the next blank you'll see there is the word predicament. There is a predicament in verse 46b. The father came from Cana and he was concerned about his sick son. Now on the positive side, the man knew that he needed Jesus. I like that. He knew where to go because he had this predicament. He had this need. On the negative side, the man is putting Jesus in a box. Now, I say that because it appears that he's limiting how God can actually work. He's putting God in a box, and this is the way you have to behave, and this is the way you have to work, and this is the way the healing is going to happen in the life of my son. And so that was the predicament that we find him. Which leads us to verse 47, which is the plea, because here he is actually stating his case. He basically begs Jesus to heal his son. We see this man as having a crisis of faith. The plea is not anything unusual, because as a parent, you would have that very same plea. Your son or your daughter is sick, and they're at the point of death, and you are desperate. You are ready to find someone that can intervene and make this all right. It's the plea of every parent. You can identify with the desperation of the man in this story. But the description of the situation reveals the man's limited faith. The text says that the man implored him to come down and heal his son. to come down and heal his son. The man basically is demonstrating a weak faith, and he believed that Jesus needed to actually be in the presence of the boy in order for the miracle to happen. You have to come down. You've got to come with me, and we're going to go, and you can heal my son. And so he was dictating how Jesus must behave. And so contrast to the situation with that town in Samaria where they believed because of the words of Jesus, not because of the miracles. And here they believe based upon the deeds and the miracles. And so it's just different. So here, this helps us to understand the seemingly harsh response in verse 48. Verse 48 states a problem. 48 states a problem. It says Jesus basically fires back, and he's lamenting the fact that these people demand that he perform miracles before they will actually believe in him. Seems like a very harsh statement to this grieving father, does it not? It's like, it seems like Jesus would be a little bit more compassionate, a little more affirming, but boy, he says this, and it seems very, very harsh. But is it not very similar to our own situation? We contrast that situation based upon what has happened and how they actually believe. Because what happens is we have this problem where he fires back. And is it not the same today? Unless God opens up the sky and reveals himself to me, I will not believe. How many times have we heard lost people say that? Unless I can, you know, God can write his name up in the sky, I will not believe. And so they're expecting a miracle just as much as back then. Unless you see these signs and wonders, you will not believe. So the signs indicated that the miracles were intended to convey a larger spiritual truth. An authentic faith does not need to be bolstered up by miracles. And the Samaritans believed without their faith being propped up by something miraculous. That's what we see in this story. But Jesus knew this man's love for his son as well as he knew about his weak faith. The man needed something to strengthen his faith. And God finds us. This is the great part. God finds us where we are and gently leads us toward maturity and spiritual strength. That's the joy of this particular section, that he meets us where we are, and he'll lead us to where we need to be. Now, this leads us to verse 49, and I would put in the word persistence. The word persistence, because out of desperation, the father continues to seek the help of Jesus. And using very similar words as before, sir, come down before my child dies. Very desperate. Literally, he's saying, my child, before my little boy dies. Very tender, very dear. This is my little boy we're talking about. You need to come down before he dies. Desperation leads to persistence, does it not? It leads to persistence. How much or how often are we much more deeply involved and committed to prayer when we're desperate? Is that not true? Because we can go weeks without prayer because things seem to be going well, but once we're desperate for something, prayer becomes much more intentional and real in our lives. When we're desperate, we don't care how it looks to other people. When we're desperate, we don't care how foolish it may seem or how we may look. When we're desperate, we need for God to intervene, and we need for God to answer. And when we're desperate, we recognize the fact if God doesn't show up, we are ruined, and it is certain failure. That is desperation. That's what this man was exercising. So we think about, when was the last time that we truly poured our heart out to God? That's something to take very seriously. When was the last time I poured out my heart to God, recognizing that there was nowhere else to turn? Let's not wait until we're desperate. Let's be people of prayer. Let's be people that come before the Father on a regular basis, not waiting for that desperation. It needs to be a part of our everyday faith. Which leads us to verse 50, and I would use the word promise here. This is what Jesus says, the boy will live. And so the man's crisis of faith is basically turning into a confident faith. He's going to live. You know, Jesus gave me his word. He gave me this promise. With the promise and assurance of Jesus, now the man has to make a choice. He has to make a choice. What are the steps that he is going to take because of what Jesus has said? Which leads me to the next point, is the path. What path is he going to take because of the information, that because of the word that Jesus just gave to him? Jesus says to go your way, meaning return to your home and return to your people. Basically, Jesus is forcing this father to believe without a miraculous sign. Go your way. Your son lives. He's got to choose. This is a choice. The man had told Jesus that he needs to come down to his town and heal the son. And I love Jesus' response. He says to go. So we're expecting him to come, and he says to go. There may be some significance in that. I don't have any deep theological insight on that. But sometimes that's what we have to do. We have to take steps of faith as we move out after he has given us what we need to do. We cannot tell Jesus how to do his work. He's the one that is in charge. Is that not correct? The man laid aside his expectations and let Jesus handle the situation as he saw fit. So this desperate father had to choose between doubting the man whom he had placed his trust and hope, or he's going to believe in Jesus, what he said, and go back home. That was the path that he needed to take. He had to choose one or the other. The man's confidence was so secure that he didn't even hurry back home. How do we know that? Well, check this out. You know, I read that there's between Cana and Capernaum, it's about a 22-mile hike. You know, you could make that in a day. That's not really too difficult. He could have done that. But all was well. He had this confident faith, and he had this confidence that everything was going to be okay. And so he travels back the following day. He's desperate, right? Wouldn't he want to run on home and make sure? He had confident faith. He travels back the next day because in verse 52 it says, so he inquired of them when the hour that the sun got better, and they said to him, yesterday at the seventh hour the fever left him. He didn't run back to make sure it happened. He had confident faith of what happened. And so when was the time that you had to make a very tough decision? I think all of us have been in that, not every week, but sometimes you have to make a very tough decision. How do we know which path to choose? Maybe both choices are equally good and both are appropriate ways to go. And you're saying, God, I just need you to show me which path I need to take. Which direction do I need to take? And I love Isaiah chapter 30, verses 20 and 21. This is what he says. Although the Lord has given you bread of adversity and water of oppression. He's given us this. Immediately we say, well, gee, thanks. But bread of adversity and the water of oppression, he, your teacher, will no longer hide himself, but your eyes will behold your teacher. And so because of this oppression and this adversity, he is no longer hidden. And so isn't that joyful that God is in the midst of our pain and our suffering and the decisions that we have to make? And so this is verse 21. Your ears will hear a word behind you. This is the way, walk in it, whenever you turn to the right or to the left. And you're thinking, okay, I want God to tell me what to do. Go to the right or to the left. And here it says, he's not going to tell you. You're going to have to choose which direction to take. And then you're going to hear this voice that said, this is the way, walk in it. He confirms after you step onto the path. I just think that's pretty cool. Which leads us, I promised only one word, but you can choose which words you want to put in this last. You can put in payoff or proof, okay, in that last blank. Payoff or proof. Verses 51 through 54. There are two things that are happening here. The first thing is the physical restoration of the heir, and then the spiritual restoration of the household. And so I'm going to finish those faith statements with these two. They basically, in verses 51 through 53a, this man has a confirmed faith. We saw the other four things at the beginning of the message, and so here is the fifth one, a confirmed faith. When the father heard the report and saw his son totally healed, his weak faith had become confirmed, the physical restoration of his heir. That's what was happening at the beginning. Sometimes just a small step of faith is all that it takes for God to open up our eyes and let us see the world from his perspective. And that's pretty doggone cool. The spiritual restoration of the household is something we also see in this passage in verses 53b into 54. And I would call this a contagious faith. Go to the next slide. It's got those other C's. There you go. And so it's confirmed faith is our fifth one. And then our contagious faith is that last blank. Because the household is also coming to faith because this man's faith was contagious. And isn't that, there's some joy in the midst of that. There's joy in the midst of that. How often have you played long and hard for a lost family member or a lost friend? You have prayed for weeks and months and years, maybe even decades, you have prayed for somebody to come to faith in Jesus Christ. And you, as a follower of Jesus, you entrust the salvation of your family member or your friend to Jesus himself. Because we know that we can't do anything to save that person. And so we're putting it into his hands, in his time, in his providence, in his way to deal with this. You may see that there's no way for that person's heart to open up to the gospel of Christ. They're just too hard. They're too skeptical. They'll never come to faith in Jesus Christ. But you continually pray anyway. You pray that there's going to be something in their life that's going to soften their heart, and they're going to come to faith in Jesus Christ. And so we just keep putting them before God's throne of grace, and that's what we strive to do. But aren't we glad that salvation does not depend upon us, it depends totally upon Him? Because unless the Father draws people to Jesus, they will not come to Jesus. There's nothing we can do. We can't guilt somebody into it. We can't encourage somebody into it. We can't convince somebody the way of Christ is the way to go. None of this stuff really works. The Father has to draw them. And so we are faithful in our praying. We are faithful also in our behavior and our testimony. Because I can imagine this man goes home and he says, "Let me tell you what happened back, you know, just 22 miles away when I talked to this man, Jesus." And so here he is testifying to the power and the love and the grace of Jesus Christ and the healing power. And the family is looking at this boy who is totally healed. And this man is testifying that that's where that healing came from. And that family can hear the words of Christ, see the change in that person, that man, that father's life, and how confident he was in his faith now, and that the household actually came to faith. It's not always a guarantee, but isn't it great to know that as we live out a life of faith, it affects other people? To me, and you know, this is not Ken's message. I had no clue what he was going to say about this passage of Scripture. But I was convinced that we needed to look at the next passage that he was going to look at. And so I'm trying to think of what is the significance of a life of faith. If we don't come to the conclusion of anything else, if the significance is as we go through life living out faith, that other people might come to faith in Christ because of our faith, the faith that they see in us. So think about the significance of living a life of faith and how it can impact the kingdom for God's sake. Your life of faith is going to speak loudly to those to whom the gospel has yet to be embraced. So have confident faith that people might come to faith in Jesus Christ. Now, when you think about the household, and we talk about it as a guarantee, we do see in the book of Acts several places where someone comes to faith in Christ and then the whole household believes. I just think the odds are much greater when a father comes to faith in Christ, primarily, you know, when the father came to faith, it's like the rest of the household began to have faith as well. It's in the book of Acts. People come to faith, and then the whole household, it's in chapter 11, chapter 16, a couple of times, chapter 8. May not be instantly, like these stories that we find in the book of Acts, but we pray that God will do wonders in our family because of the faith that we are exercising and demonstrating. And so live a gospel-empowered life in front of your friends and your family on a regular basis. I believe this is the significance of faith. On the bottom of your bulletin, there's two extra blanks at the bottom. There's actually three. Maybe the printer didn't like that last one at the bottom. But the movement of this father's faith. And so I just want to show you the movement of this man's faith. First, he had faith in Jesus' power. Because he went to Jesus for a reason. He went because of the power that Jesus had demonstrated. And then the man's faith was in Jesus' promise. Because Jesus had made the promise, therefore the faith was something that... he was having faith in the promises. And then finally, as he goes back home, he has faith in Jesus' person. In faith in Jesus' person. Now, I have to admit, the children's bulletin this week doesn't have this passage because I was going to talk about 2 Timothy chapter 1 about faith and what that means. Because if you think about it, I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him until that day. I know what? Right doctrine? I know what? Right Bible verses? Verse 12 of that chapter says, I know whom. I know the right person. I know the right person, and that makes all the difference. Faith is willful, it's dynamic, it's lifelong, it's progressive, and at times it is not very easy. But by following Jesus by faith, it is totally worth it. It is totally worth it. So where are you in this story? The story starts out with sickness, anxiety, desperation. This man is walking in the valley of the shadow of death, literally. But it ends up with rejoicing, confidence, hope, healing, and wholeness. Just in this one story. And so that's the story reading in the scripture. And so we have to think about where does this story fit into our lives? Where have we lived a life or have been a part of desperation and anxiety? Not exactly sure the next steps that we need to take, but then God breaks through. And because of faith, we're able to have confidence, rejoicing, hope, and wholeness because encountering the risen Savior. That's what this story is all about. It's not just a story on the page. It is the story of us. How can we have the same life of faith? And so today, maybe you need to get on the right path. Maybe you need to let Jesus into your life. Maybe you've never done that before. Follow him with all your heart and with all your mind, with all your soul and with all your strength, and enter into the salvation that he so freely offers. To bring that wholeness to you spiritually. Or maybe you just need to join this church. You know, choose this path. After all, if you've been a regular attendee for so long, maybe this is why Jesus brought you here. You're a committed part of this congregation. You feel the warm fellowship, but maybe it's time to declare your commitment to Christ and to this church. And so we're going to sing a song here that is, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus, because that is the perfect song to finish a message like this, because it is so sweet to trust in Jesus. And so I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to sing this song. And if there's something that you'd like to deal with God about, need some extra prayer, join this church, receive Christ as your Savior, I'd love for that to happen today. But sometimes we just make commitments in the privacy of our own seat, and that's okay. That's okay. But if you need to come forward, I'd love to pray with you. So I'm going to pray for us, and then we'll sing this final song.